President, yesterday the Senate Judiciary Committee began to hear witnesses on the nomination of Bill Barr to be the next Attorney General of the United States. We heard first, of course, from Mr. Barr himself all day yesterday, and today from additional witnesses. By any standard, Mr. Barr is an exceptionally qualified individual, in part because 27 years ago, he was Attorney General then, too, nominated and confirmed unanimously, nominated by President George Herbert Walker Bush. Under his leadership at the time, the Department of Justice focused on some of the most important law enforcement challenges facing our country at that time. They worked to fight violent crime and combat the drug epidemic, both of which continue to do great harm to communities across the country still today. As significant as the work done under his leadership was, I was more impressed with the fact that after 27 years, he was willing to take on the task of becoming Attorney General once again. He said he was sort of semi-retired. He and his wife were looking forward to spending more time with their children and grandchildren, but he answered the call to public service, and I, for one, am grateful that he did. He knows that our nation needs a strong law and order Attorney General in the Department of Justice. When he spoke at his confirmation hearing more than 2.5 decades ago, he said, "The Attorney General must ensure that the administration of justice, the enforcement of the law, is above and away from politics. Nothing could be more destructive of our system of government, the rule of law, or the Department of Justice as an institution than any toleration of political interference with the enforcement of the law." He repeated that commitment yesterday, and I think the need for that sort of strong statement is more important today than ever. I believe Attorney General Barr will be a good Attorney General, assuming what is one of the most challenging positions in the Cabinet, because you're both a political appointee, yet you are also the chief law enforcement officer in the country. That sometimes can be difficult to navigate. As the nominee noted, doing the job and doing it well sometimes requires being prepared to burn your political capital in order to preserve the rule of law. I believe that this is the most fundamental quality of a good Attorney General, and having a leader at the helm of the Department of Justice with the right temperament and a fundamental understanding of this responsibility is critical, now and forever. In recent years, we've witnessed some attorneys general carrying out actions that at least repeatedly towed that political line, sometimes and crossed it. Under the Obama administration, the Department of Justice began to veer increasingly away from the impartial administration of law and toward politics. That shift undoubtedly occurred at the hands of President Obama's attorneys general, who were in the driver's seat during his administration, Eric Holder and Loretta Lynch. The conduct of both Holder and Lynch has come under a great deal of scrutiny even now after they have left, and for a good reason. For example, under then Attorney General Holder, there was something called Operation Fast and Furious, in which the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and the Department of Justice purposefully allowed the illegal sale of firearms into Mexico in the hopes of being able to track them. Unfortunately, there were a number of casualties, including Border Patrolman Brian Terry, who was killed with one of those firearms in 2010. Attorney General Holder never accepted responsibility for Brian Terry's death or ever admitted that allowing these guns to walk into Mexico into the hands of some criminal organizations was a terrible mistake. And then under his watch, the IRS targeting controversy occurred, in which politically aligned groups applying for tax-exempt status faced official oppression based upon their political affiliation. And then, of course, more recently, let's not forget then-Attorney General Lynch's handling of the Clinton email scandal, something even James Comey, the FBI director, objected to, and along with her famous so-called tarmac meeting with former President Bill Clinton when his wife was under an active FBI investigation. The conduct of both Holder and Lynch undermined the public's confidence in the impartial administration of justice, of law, at the Justice Department. Under the leadership of my friend and our former colleague, Jeff Sessions, the Department of Justice has begun to right the ship and again separate politics from impartial administration of the law. And I'm confident that Mr. Barr will continue to do the same. During his confirmation hearing, Mr. Barr reaffirmed that politicians should not interfere with criminal investigations, and he likewise committed to not interfere with the special counsel's investigation. He assured us that his allegiance will be to the rule of law and to the Constitution and the American people, and that above all else, he will work to protect the professionalism and integrity of the Department of Justice and the thousands of dedicated public servants who work there. Not only is Mr. Barr exceptionally qualified for the job, he's prepared on day one to step in and lead with distinction. The Senate unanimously confirmed his nomination to three different positions at the Department of Justice, and I hope we can work expeditiously to get this fine man to the Department of Justice once again. I thank Mr. Barr and his entire family for agreeing to bring his talents and his temperament to the Department of Justice at a time when those qualities are so desperately needed, and I look forward to voting yes on his nomination. Mr. President, on another matter, I want to share a few words about the passing of one of the airline industry's most unconventional and most successful executives. That would be Herb Kelleher, who co-founded Southwest Airlines. Herb was born in 1931 in New Jersey, and his young life and early career kept him on the East Coast. He graduated from Wesleyan University and New York University School of Law and served as a law clerk for 2 years at the New Jersey Supreme Court, and then joined a law firm in Newark. But his fate intervened in this promising young lawyer's career. He met his wife, Joan, a native Texan, and they decided to move to the Lone Star State, something he later referred to as the greatest business decision he ever made. Building America's largest domestic airline carrier was never on Herb's to-do list. In the late 60s, he was an attorney in San Antonio when one day his client approached him with an idea about a low-fare airline serving three Texas cities. Tired of spending so much in the car, traveling between San Antonio and Houston and Dallas, he believed they could make point-to-point intrastate travel faster and much cheaper by flying, and also cheaper than other airlines. Getting their innovative idea off the ground wasn't easy. These men who founded Southwest Airlines slogged through years of legal battles before the airline operated its first flight. Their vision not only led to the creation of a budget airline, but also drove down the costs of their competitors, as competition will do. And to maintain their edge, Southwest tried some interesting ideas along the way. After another airline ran an ad calling Southwest a cheap carrier, Herb responded by filming a commercial where he wore a brown paper bag over his head and promised that the airline would gladly provide one to any customer too embarrassed to be seen flying on Southwest Airlines. At one point, to compete with the low fares of other airlines, Southwest started a program to keep customers. They said you can either pay the lowest fare or pay full fare and get a free premium bottle of liquor in the process. Well, apparently it worked, and for a short time, I'm told, Southwest was the largest liquor distributor in the state of Texas. But I think one of the most distinctly Herb Kelleher stories is of a battle called the Malice in Dallas. In 1992, Southwest Airlines and another company realized their slogans, plain smart and just plain smart, were similar. Rather than settling the matter in court, they settled it by holding a public arm wrestling match. The 61-year-old with a cigarette fixed between his teeth gave his much younger competitor a run for his money, but he couldn't pull off a win. At the end of the match, the two men made donations to each other's chosen charities. They agreed to share the slogan and called it a day. Each of these stories has Herb Kelleher written all over it. He was known for his gregarious personality, his incredible work ethic, and his penchant for the non-traditional, not to mention his affinity for wild turkey. I first met Herb when I represented him in a lawsuit early in my legal career in San Antonio. He had a larger-than-life personality, and it was a pleasure to know him. We can all learn a lesson from Herb about the importance of working hard, treating people with respect, and not being afraid to have a little bit of fun along the way. His entrepreneurial spirit was credited with democratizing the skies by disrupting the airline industry, and I believe he was one of the most consequential leaders in modern aviation, and we've all benefited from that. So I join Herb's wife, Joan, his children, his grandchildren, his many friends, and of course his beloved Southwest Airlines family in mourning the loss of this larger-than-life figure. Mr. President, I yield the floor.